We are about to unfold the story of Frankenstein, a man of science who sought to create a man after his own image. It is one of the strangest tales ever told. I think it will thrill you. It may shock you. It might even horrify you.
Welcome to the now playing Universal Films Frankenstein movie retrospective series.
It's alive!
Hosted by Jakob.
I'd hate to find him under my bed at night.
Arnie.
You think I'm mad? Perhaps I am.
And Stuart.
England's greatest sinner.
This episode will contain detailed plot spoilers and strong language.
So if any of you feel that you do not care to subject your nerves to such a strain, well, we've warned you.
We hope you enjoy the show.
To a new world of gods and monsters.
Today we're discussing Frankenstein, starring Colin Clive, Mae Clark, John Bowles, Boris Karloff, Dwight Fry, Edward Van Sloan, Frederick Kerr, directed by James Whale. This is the now playing co-host who wants you to feed his Frankenstein, Arnie.
And Stuart.
And this is the co-host who knows what it feels like to be a god, Jakob.
Welcome back to the Universal Monsters Retrospective. We did Dracula. We weren't sure when slash if we'd get back to it. But hey, it's January. There's a lull of things coming out in theaters. And what better time to go back to the 1930s for now playing?
No one's in theaters, and yeah, nothing new to review.
Yeah, we had just done Gone with the Wind. Maybe I'm feeling, a 30s pull, and I don't know. Yeah, this is the obvious next choice. If we've done Dracula, where to go to next? I do feel like, Frankenstein is a biggie, and was the follow-up that they made. Right after Dracula, they said we needed another monster movie hit. They went to Mary Shelley.
Now, I've never seen this movie, and until this week, I'd never read the book of Frankenstein. I mean, I've seen Frankenstein in movies, Monster Squad, and I know the stereotypes of Frankenstein, but honestly, I'm kind of a newbie to Frankenstein coming in. How are you guys? Have you guys seen this before?
Yeah, this is the one Universal monster classic that I have seen. I think I told the story with Dracula. Like, my dad showed me Young Frankenstein by Mel Brooks. I'm like, I feel like I'm not getting the references here because I'm a child and I haven't seen Frankenstein. So then he put on Universal's Frankenstein for me and I watched that. And there is a scene in that, we'll talk about it, that has stuck with me ever since being a little child. But then I rediscovered this when I was in college. I took a sci-fi as literature class and learned, like, this is considered to be the first sci-fi novel.
Weird. All right. I don't even think of it as sci-fi, but I guess you can make that case.
It is a mad scientist.
Yeah. No, I get it. Yeah. I have read Mary Shelley's work before, and I have seen this movie and the next one. I have seen 1931, Boris Karloff, Frankenstein, and His Bride. And one thing that I really want to stress, maybe it's the reason why we're doing this retrospective, kind of like Stephen King shining, Kubrick shining, everything that you think about with Frankenstein, everything you think about is not in that book. It is not like lightning that brings a creature alive, not there. Little girl thrown in a pond, not there. Bolts in the neck, green skin, not there.
No. Not even stitched together corpses. I did audiobook Frankenstein before this review, and I was stunned because I felt like I knew what I was going to get. I haven't seen this 1931 Frankenstein. Did I need to? I know it's alive! It's alive! I've seen Weird Science. I've seen Young Frankenstein more than a dozen times. So do I need to see this film to know what Frankenstein is? And so I listened to the book thinking that I was going to just get what I already knew. And no, there is nothing in this movie from that book. I was astonished how mopey that book was. I gotta say, I didn't love the book.
I hated it. I'll be honest. I don't know where you were at, Jakob, reading it for school. That's a double whammy. They're making you read it. And then, you call that sci-fi and oof, Yeah, it's just hard to relate to the characters. I'll die on the hill that I enjoyed Bram Stoker's Dracula. I know you guys said it felt too old in its writing, but this one you can have. Yeah, I did not find any entertainment. The way it was set up, it was a series of letters, a guy telling his girlfriend that he's on a boat with a guy who maybe invented a zombie. Oof. Yuck.
Yeah, I'll say this. I liked some of the concepts of Mary Shelley's book in that I viewed it as a parallel for man's relationship with God. God created man, and he used to do all these miracles. He used to cause floods and turn people into pillars of salt. Where's God now? Where's God gone? And so in this book, Victor Frankenstein is God. He makes his creation and then disappears and leaves his creation on his own. And the creation gets to come together with his maker and say, basically, why did you make me? Why did you do this to me? Why am I the only one of my type? I liked some of the religious parable, but I didn't like the book.
Yeah, I loved it when it was called Blade Runner. Yeah, here's the fact.
I think Frankenstein came first.
Yeah, this is what is the problem with a classic that is this old, you know, 1818 is what we're talking about. The Enlightenment, okay? We're going way, 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 way back. Your great-grandparents weren't alive when this book was written, okay? It's just been absorbed by culture. Like, the idea of it, yes, Arnie, from a religious standpoint, from a standpoint about where we are now with AI and developing artificial intelligence, and anytime man innovates, the whole idea that science is doing the work of God, and will we be punished for that? I think Frankenstein looms large. If Mary Shelley didn't write it, somebody else would, because I think it's a fundamental story about the human condition. But that book sucks. Just the pose, the pacing, the characters, blech.
I agree. It was really not a good story, not a good vision. I'll say whatever I think of this 1931 movie, I certainly like the universal concept of Frankenstein more than I like Mary Shelley's original. It was just, again, so downtrodden and, yeah, all in the first person, which was really annoying to read after a while because it shifts perspective, but it's still first person. And the monster just really is not a great creation.
Mm-mm. Unrelatable, yeah, and very verbose. Like, I love the fact that in this movie, it just, but in that novel, it's like, blah, blah, blah. He'll tell stories about characters we never even meet. I'm like, oh, God, someone shut him up. Take his lips off, at least. Pull out the tongue.
Yeah, that's the best thing I can say about the audiobook is it was short. It was only like 9 hours. After doing Gone with the Wind for 40 hours.
That short. Yeah. That's all perspective. Yeah, I mean, 9 hours is a lot of time, but yeah, shorter than Gone with the Wind, which is available. Just want to tell people, great epic show. We just put it out for December patrons. Go check it out. But not unlike Dracula, there are a lot of parallels between Frankenstein and Dracula, and one of them is Universal didn't get there first. Just as Bela Lugosi wasn't the first person to put on the fangs and the cape, Frankenstein was first made by Thomas Edison in his lab in 1910 as a 12-minute short.
Okay, as a movie, not a real Frankenstein. You're talking Thomas Edison here.
Well, you know, like there was the Nosferatu, you know, like there was a silent movie, Dracula, and there was a silent movie, Frankenstein. And, you know, did anything influence? I think, you know, obviously, I think at least Jacob and maybe Arnie, you came down with the idea that Nosferatu was better than Universal's Dracula.
Oh, 100%. I did not recommend Bela Lugosi's Dracula. It is a ill-constructed film.
Yeah, but I mean, it's barely a movie. I mean, again, it's one of those exercises where like there's four scenes, okay? Like Frankenstein, I'm going away to school. Goodbye, wife. And then he cuts to the school, looks up from a book, goes, I have an idea. Like holds up his finger. That, you know, that shows I have an idea. Throws something in a pot. Some smoke comes out. A guy with a hunchback and a bad wig jumps out. I think the idea that they might have taken, the only thing that I can see that might have influenced Universal was he had an oversized cranium, that his head was enlarged. And other than that, you know, if you read the Mary Shelley prose, there's barely any description of Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm.
I got the sense that he barely had skin. I had the sense that said he was just like a translucent human being slithering around. And here they have the idea of someone with a very big head popping out of a plate and then chasing this Victor Frankenstein back to his wife and being defeated, I'm told by an intertitle, by the power of love. He just couldn't stand their marriage and it was all over. So there, I've saved you. You can go watch it on YouTube if you want. But that was the original concept. And there were a couple other ones too, but, you know, have been lost to time. Early films, they're, you know, flammable. They're tucked away somewhere and people die and they don't know where it is anymore. Lots of lost films.
Any idea? Do they stick more to the book? Do we know at all what they covered? Those lost films?
Not really. A few people have seen them and there's no images that I've seen pulled from them. So I don't think that they were a reference. I've read about what influenced Universal and it wasn't any other filmed Frankenstein. They were more into the play. Also like Dracula, it was on stage as a hit before it was in all the movie plexes. In fact, it was commissioned. The guy who had a hit on Broadway with Dracula said, let's do something for the off nights. Let's do another monster mash. And so we have this guy, Hamilton Dean. He was touring Frankenstein around the UK. It never came to America, but he had a play version of this. That was actually kind of minimalist. You would think they'd have a lot of fun with lightning and all of that. But the Frankenstein, their idea was he looked almost exactly like Victor Frankenstein. The only difference was one had a green face, one, you know, probably played by an English actor. But it was a look-alike. And so they didn't go a lot for crazy visuals. But they extracted the framework that we think of as the Frankenstein story. Mad scientist, limping henchmen, stealing brains. None of the stuff that's in the Mary Shelley novel, invented for the stage first. And became the boilerplate for when Universal said, we need another monster movie, quick, get us a script. The funny thing is, after Dracula, you'd think a hit that big, they'd be in the clover, but they had to lay off like 2,000 people the next month. Dracula wasn't enough to save the financial troubles Universal was going through, and so they needed very badly a sequel. And so we're going to just do Frankenstein with Bela Lugosi. That was the plan. We'll just take the cape off, put on the bolts, and we got another hit. 8 months later, it comes out. So they rushed this thing to the screen. But of course, the reason why we didn't get that version, a couple reasons. I kind of would kill to see the makeup test.
You can't have those sexy Lugosi eyes on a Frankenstein.
Yeah, he was like, I'm not a makeup Lon Chaney kind of guy. I'm not a man of 1,000 faces. I don't want to put on prosthetics. And so he was like, you could put some clay on me. Like, their whole emphasis was they looked at the golem. It was like a 1920s silent movie about a statue that came to life. And he had like this big afro and like clay all over his face. And people were laughing. They said, that's not Frankenstein. That's not scary. And Bela was like, well, this is all I'm going to do. Because I want to play the mad scientist. And I want to have a speaking part. I think that this, you know, running around grunting and killing people is stuff for, I think he called it a witless extra.
Enter Boris Karloff.
Yes, yes. And then the other thing that happened was that Universal had a hit with this English director who had come to America. And, you know, all the people that worked in theaters were in high demand because talkies were the thing. And so, you know, their old movie guys didn't know how dialogue worked, didn't know how to direct actors through vocal performances. And so here was a guy that had a big hit. They asked him, you can do anything. We got 30 projects lined up. What do you want to do? And James Whale says, oh, I want to play in the macabre. Most of what I've done are comedies and World War I melodramas. I want to do something a little bit darker. I want to do Frankenstein. So he was in, Bela was out, and yes, he was walking around the commissary. I guess it was really late in production. This thing filmed in August, September, and was out by November. But they didn't have a Frankenstein until about mid-July. And he was just walking around the Universal commissary, saw Boris Karloff eating, a bit player who had worked in probably 60 movies and never had a breakout role.
So it really was an extra.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, that's a little bit cruel. He had had, I kind of want to see it. Apparently, he had had some success playing villains. He played somebody addicted to cocaine, some kind of cocaine cowboy or something like that.
Like in the 20s?
Yeah, no, I mean, keep in mind, 1931, there is no code.
Yeah, true.
So they are able to do things. There were movies released with nudity in it. I mean, like, not all the major studios were into that.
There's Tarzan films. I was shocked to hell when I saw Tarzan with complete nude women in it. Yeah. And I'm like, when did this happen? How was this allowed?
Yeah, 1931 is a very different story than, 1934, when they have production code come in and Hayes' office is like, no more of this. So, yeah, they just said, we can have a cocaine cracked out like cowboy. And it sounds like a compliment and an insult at the same time. James Whale walked up to him and is like, your face has the potential to be a horrible monster. And guy needed work. So he's like, okay, let's try this out.
And it became a career-making role. I mean, when you think of Boris Karloff, you think of Frankenstein. I did look him up and saw that he had worked a lot before then. He did radio, he did movies, but yeah, nothing I'd ever heard of until we get to Frankenstein. Not that I probably would have heard of most of those 1920s productions.
Yeah, and other people got booted too. Like, it was supposed to be Betty Davis as the leading lady. That stiff, Leslie Howard, Arnie, we just watched Gone with the Wind. But the one Scarlett was obsessed with, Ashley, he was going to be Dr. Frankenstein, and Will basically got to pick his cast, threw the old choices away, and went forward with people he had worked with before on his melodramas. And his references, I mentioned that there were silent films they looked at. He went to the Germans, Metropolis. We covered that film. You can tell, I think, in the angular sets that they have when you see the lab.
Oh, I for sure had German Expressionism written down at a few points.
Mm-hmm. Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, which is kind of a Frankenstein story. It's about a sleepwalker, but mind control. Yeah, I definitely think that he was taking a lot of inspiration. The Germans really influenced the universal horror film look. And so, yeah, they shot it in 6 weeks at about $300,000, and it made $12 million. It was a mega hit.
$12 million in their dollars?
Yes, in their dollars.
That's a lot.
That is, yeah, nobody else got fired. Yeah, that's the good news, is that all the layoffs that were happening that summer, you can relax now. Frankenstein has saved a day. Dracula started the turnaround, but it was Frankenstein that saved the studio. So let's find out what they did. Arnie, give us the plot.
Henry Frankenstein. Not Victor Frankenstein, which is what I always thought, but Henry Frankenstein.
No, there's Victor, but that's a different character in this. It's confusing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's in the book. It was Victor. Again, another change. One of the 10,000.
And he had a friend named Henry in the book.
Yes, I know. Did someone not read the book well?
The screenwriter, yeah, just got confused when they were adapting it.
Yes. I bet you, we joke, but I bet you that might have been how it started. They took it from the play, but I'm telling you, yeah, them playwrights weren't reading that prose.
Henry Frankenstein is a mad scientist obsessed with discovering the secret of life itself. He wants to create life, but rather than do that with his fiancée Elizabeth, Frankenstein has his assistant Fritz digging up corpses and stealing brains so that Frankenstein may give life to a creature made from the pieces of dead bodies. Elizabeth tries to intervene and bring Frankenstein back home, so she goes to his tower, accompanied by their friend Victor and Frankenstein's old teacher, Dr. Waldman. Instead of getting Frankenstein to leave, they stay as witnesses to his experiment. He succeeds in bringing the creature to life, but this creature is pure instinct. It kills Frankenstein's assistant Fritz, so Frankenstein and Dr. Waldman decide to poison and kill the monster. They do, and Frankenstein returns home to marry his fiancée, while Dr. Waldman stays to autopsy the monster's body. But Frankenstein's monster is not dead. He kills Dr. Waldman and escapes Frankenstein's laboratory. Out in the countryside, it also kills a little girl. It then moves on and interrupts Frankenstein's wedding day. The little girl's father comes and starts a mob to hunt for his daughter's murderer. Frankenstein leads some of the search party, but he is captured by the monster. The creature throws Frankenstein from atop a windmill, but Frankenstein survives the fall. Then the townspeople set fire to the windmill, with Frankenstein's monster inside. It seems Frankenstein's monster is killed in the blaze, while Frankenstein himself recovers from his fall, and credits roll.
And as we get started, they did this in Dracula. Right at the end, they had Edward Van Sloan come out. He was the man that played Van Helsing. Here, he's going to be playing the mentor scientist, Waldman. He's going to try to do some kind of preface to let the religious folks in the audience know they're going to be offended, that this is a story about a man who didn't reckon with God when he tried to create something in his image.
I got to ask, how serious was this? Because this feels almost like a carnival barker. It's going to shock and horrify you. But, like, there is child murder in this. We talked a little bit about the Hays Code and the pre-code days and all that. But were there actual legit worries, and that's why they put this warning, if you want to call it that, at the beginning?
I think it works as both. I agree. In some ways, it's just kind of giddy fun to be like, oh yeah, right, can we handle it here? But there are stories about people that when they see the monster 30 minutes in, ran out of the theaters and huddled in the corner and couldn't handle it. Keep in mind, it was a very innocent time in which people, you know, they weren't exposed to prosthetics yet. The movie monster makeup wasn't a thing. So maybe it did traumatize a few people. But I think the outrage was more about the sacrilege, that they were anticipating rightly that, yes, the religious groups would protest the idea of someone trying to act as a god. Arnie, the thing you thought was interesting about the book was the thing they anticipated correctly that would get this movie censored. And indeed, not so much on its initial 1931 run, but when they re-released it in the later parts of the 30s, they would have to cut things out. The girl getting thrown in the pond had to go. Like, they wouldn't show parts of this movie for several decades.
And so when we get started past that little warning, we're introduced to our Frankenstein and his assistant Fritz. Isn't his assistant Igor?
Where's Igor?
Yeah, I believe that is coming.
Or Igor, if you've seen Young Frankenstein.
Yes.
I believe that is an invention of a later Frankenstein movie we'll be covering. But I was surprised. No Igor in the book, no Igor in the play, no Igor here. Yeah, Fritz, I don't know. Are they in Germany? I don't know exactly where we're supposed to be. There's a burgomaster, and I had to Google what that was.
Not someone who eats hamburgers.
Right. It sounds like someone that would, like rule over a hamlet, and Hamlet feels like... Yeah, Bavaria, Germany.
Yeah, I took this as some kind of German, Austria, somewhere in that area.
Yeah, in that general Eastern European, not so near Transylvania, but not so far either.
Yeah, I was wondering when this was, where this was. I mean, is this taking place in the early 19th century like the book, or is this taking place when the movie came out?
I gotta figure this is like almost fairy tale days, like the Frankenstein's... Do they run this village? Like, everyone's super excited about their wedding and all. Like, they seem very prominent. I don't know why their son is digging up corpses.
Yeah. The intention was to be vague and timeless, I think was a word used to describe it. You weren't supposed to peg a particular region or year. You know, we don't have that in any of the intertitles to give it. But you could read it, I suppose, as a modern day story. It kind of plays like... something, it's how I imagine Europe, Germany to be in the 19th century. It feels 100 years earlier than the release of this movie.
I just love this graveyard that we start off on that has a giant statue of death, like a big skeleton in a robe with a scythe. That is a wonderful, comforting image when you come to visit your past loved ones. I mean, I don't know why they don't put them in all graveyards.
Yeah. You want that as your headstone? Maybe. I mean, it's got character. One thing I'm appreciating, when you think about Dracula, a lot of the times that camera didn't move. It was filmed like a play. You had a wide shot and that was it. And if something happened, someone's like, oh, something ran by the window. We did not get an insert confirming what that was.
No insert shots infuriated me.
Yeah. Here, I definitely feel like we are getting close-ups. The camera is tracking and moving and it's just more animated. I feel like we're in better filmmaking hands than we were in Bela's picture.
Somewhat. I can feel some of the shoddiness, like when Fritz is supposed to climb up to cut down a body. You could just tell they didn't have all the props there. They didn't have all of the continuity that you'd have today. It was just suddenly he's up on top.
Yeah, it's still a 1930s production, but I, like you, Stuart, I feel I'm in better hands, which is sad because I like Todd Browning, but this director, he's doing all the fundamentals that you want in a film.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Todd Browning is a good director.
Though still no score. This is going to make $12 million. Maybe that will give Universal the money to put a score in their movies.
Yeah, here's the thing. 1931, keep this in perspective. Talkies are relatively new. It just wasn't done. Nobody was putting music in the movie. You have it at the beginning. You have it at the end. There's a little bit of credit sequence where we saw some claws and some spinning eyes. That's the only time you're going to get music. And that is just the standard in 1931. It will change, obviously, by the mid-30s. They figure out that scores are important. But there is no credited composer in this movie. Grave robbing. Yeah, again, this was always a thing, right? They grabbed the wrong brain. They took the brain of a criminal, is the way that I thought I understood the story. Definitely not in the Mary Shelley incarnation. And here, I don't think we are to know who they're burying. I don't, good person, bad person. They're getting the body, right? They're only taking the torso?
Yeah, because they're going to collect another body after this, but there's going to be a problem with the brainstem, so the brain is useless. So later, Frankenstein's going to tell us he stitched these bodies together, so I guess we're never given a reason why, though, I don't think. Like, we're just to assume that's what happens.
Right. Why not just reanimate a corpse? I guess it's part of the magic that maybe it's part of his, I don't know, ego that he gets to create something original. I think the line is said that, like, it was never alive. I created it. You know, like, to him, he has assembled a new thing, not reanimated a corpse.
I definitely have issues with some of the claims he makes. Yeah, he's not making, like, cells and skin and muscle and bone, like he remix, as you said. And I'm going to give this film a lot because it's 1931. I would hope in a more modern day version of this, you'd get a more psychological exploration of what makes Frankenstein tick. I feel like everything with his motivation is, it's very just one note. I want to make life. I'm a mad scientist.
Yeah. And mixed in with that, the feeling that people are pretty squeamish. We can't show, definitely can't show limbs being cut off and assembled and all of that stuff. Gore is not going to be here. So it leaves a lot to the imagination. Maybe that's a problem. But the reason why they don't take the brain, at least from the second corpse they find, is he was hung at the gallows. This is still a time when people just, you're guilty of a crime, we're just going to hang you and leave you there for days. I don't think they do that in 1931.
No, I would hope not.
And that's a good point. Just, who knows what they do overseas 100 years ago, right? But
I mean, again, if this is Germany in the 30s, creepy time.
But yes, because his neck was broken, that brain was no good. So we cut to a school where there just happened to be a couple of brains right there being demonstrated to med students.
And I think it's night. Like, this is night school. It's very convenient, I guess, for creepy people lurking around. You got to have class for them so you can steal a brain.
Yeah, this is where I start laughing. Like, I feel like Frankenstein is always talked about a monster. This is Universal monster movies, horror movies. But Frankenstein is kind of a dark comedy, right? There's a lot that's kind of silly. There's a lot we have to sort of just give me the science of this. Once this professor starts talking about how certain lobes on the brain make it obvious that this person was a criminal and this person is a good person. I mean, there's no support for that. That is just hooey.
What? You can't tell someone by the lumps on their head what kind of personality they have? That's been discredited?
Yeah, I think that's out of fashion, Jacob, phrenology. But I ask you, worth asking, we'll have this, it's a slapstick bit, it's a comedy bit, that this hunchback guy climbs through the window after class breaks, grabs the normal brain, drops it, goes, okay, I guess I'll take the abnormal brain. But would it matter? Like, just take the humor away from that. Is the monster we're going to meet a criminal? Does he kill because he is abnormal? I don't read the story that way.
Yeah, what type of criminal is he? It's not like we see him stealing. He's not a cat burglar criminal. I mean, is he a murderer? He will kill and we'll discuss it, but he doesn't kill for pleasure, I don't think.
Right.
He gets highly abused. I feel like a lot of people would turn to murder in the situation that he'll be put in.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I feel like that's what we're supposed to draw. The conclusion is because it's this abnormal killer's brain. That's why Frankenstein is the monster he is. If he got that regular brain, he would have been able to talk to, I don't know, dance around. Who knows what?
He could sing Putting on the Ritz like in Young Frankenstein.
Yes, I was trying not to reference that, but yes.
It's kind of hard. If you've seen the Mel Brooks movie.
And I rewatched it just after this to refresh myself, yeah.
Oh, no. Yeah. I intentionally am avoiding it because I want to experience this movie. Funny or not, I want to experience it as it was intended and not as it's so easily satirized.
There were only a couple of Young Frankenstein things I couldn't get out of my mind. And one of them was the Abby normal brain.
Yes.
That was the one when he's taking abnormal brain here. That was the one time Young Frankenstein overrode the movie I was watching at the moment.
But I think it's a very modern perspective to say that, yeah, you can look at an abnormal brain and that person does bad things and a normal person would never kill. Like that, that's just why the morality of this movie is not going to really work.
Yeah, I'm willing to look past a lot of things with this because it is 1931. Phrenology is popular at this time. So the fact that, yeah, lumpy brain, bad person, okay, I just got to give it. I'm not going to get that kind of exploration of human nature, what actually makes you tick. If you got a fresh restart of you, is it your brain? Is it nature or nurture? We had that debate with Trading Places, but in 1931, this is a monster movie, and it's fun to see a brain smash on the ground.
Yeah, it works as comedy. That's where I'll just leave it. It's funny to watch a hunchback guy break the brain he was supposed to take and be like, I guess I'll not tell anyone. It kind of works. This is my kind of review for the movie. It kind of works as Young Frankenstein more than it does as a thoughtful science fiction story.
I want to know why Henry Frankenstein didn't notice that he had an abnormal brain. What kind of scientist is he?
Yeah, he didn't look at the sticker.
No, he takes the whole jar.
Yeah, I wondered if Fritz would do sticker swapping or something to remove the abnormal brain sticker, but no. I gotta say, I like Fritz. When you're talking about this comedic aspect, I think a lot of it surrounds this character of Fritz. He's kind of put upon, and I enjoy watching this actor in this subservient role.
Now, he was the best thing about Dracula. It's the same character that played Renfield, Dwight Fry. He just had this.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He'll keep popping up. In fact, my understanding is he's in several of the Universal Monsters, always playing, maybe he'll be an Igor at one point, but always playing the kind of crazy henchman.
But once they get the brain, fortunately, this movie is short. It's only about 70 minutes, and things are going to move along pretty quickly here. We're going to get to Frankenstein's tower laboratory. Did they say it's a lighthouse?
It is not a lighthouse. When they started production on this, it was a windmill. And then they decided the windmill was going to be the climax, and it became a watchtower.
A watchtower.
Yeah, and it's these stairs that felt very German expressionism to me. They just like wind out of nowhere the way it's shot.
Yeah, it reminded me of Dracula in that way, where they had the big staircase from his cellar. But Frankenstein's experiment is going to get interrupted by his fiance and his friend and the doctor. We had a scene of the three of them. They're very worried about Henry.
I'm wondering how much of this comes through. I did do some of the bonus materials. There's a commentary track by a film historian. I'm no longer sure what I took from dialogue and what was told to me. Did you guys pick up? I think it's obvious you pick up that this guy, Victor, is into Elizabeth, right? That part of why he's showing concern for Henry is he just wants to sidle up with her.
There's a line regarding that where he says that he'd be there for her or something like that. There's one line, but it doesn't go anywhere.
He'd do anything for her. And I think that, you know, she kind of, that's when she's like, well, I'm coming too. Do you understand that she is in an arranged marriage? That the father Frankenstein, the Baron, is the one that from childhood hooked her up with Henry, and that she'd much rather be with this guy?
No.
No, I didn't get that from the movie. I got that from the book, but not from the movie.
Okay. I'm not sure it is here.
In the book, it's great for the Pornhub goers because they're step siblings.
I think having that knowledge is helpful, though, because again, it's like these characters have chemistry. And at a certain point, Henry's going to be like, watch over this woman. You know, like, otherwise, why do we need this guy? Like, he is the one that seems capable of love, whereas Henry is consumed by science. He can't be bothered and never probably has cared about this woman. It's an arranged marriage put upon him by his father, but he's married to his, you know, equipment, his microscope. And we got Edward Van Sloan coming back as well, the guy that played Van Helsing, the professor that was so important in slaying Dracula. He's Waldman here, talking about his former student, being obsessed with electrobiology. chemical galvanism, whatever these things are. He knew that when the kid was enrolled in university, he was both brilliant and erratic, and is now very sad to see him, descend into this way. Yeah, he's telling them that he is going to raise the dead in front of them.
Yeah, this is where in a modern day telling, his mom died or something, and he, you know, it's the Anakin Skywalker thing. I couldn't save my mom, so I turned to the dark arts. Like, yeah, he's gone crazy. He's obsessed. I get that. Like, he's obsessed with this, but I'll never know why. And is that because it's 1931? Is it because it's an adaptation of the play? It's not in the book? I don't know, but it's something I would like to see more of.
It's not in the book either, really. He becomes obsessed with it. He talks about he'd been obsessed with alchemy and various things from a very young age, but he's just a mad scientist for mad scientist's sake there as well. I do love the scene, though, where his fiance comes to the tower with Victor and Dr. Waldman. It's pouring out. He looks out a barred window and it's just like, go away. And it's just going to leave them out in the rain.
Again, it might be helpful to realize, if it comes through good on you and catching, it's not here enough, that this guy is not interested in obviously coming home and getting married to her, that there is no real love there. That, yeah, he's doing exactly what he wants to.
And I just took it as him being obsessed with work and ignoring his fiance. I didn't read any arranged marriage or anything into that.
Yeah, that's how I took it as well, as he's just a mad scientist who's more into the science than the girl. But I didn't get anything about the arranged marriage out of this.
Mm-hmm. I guess as a viewer, I don't think we're wanting that to get corrected. I don't feel like at any given point I'm connected to Henry and want him to acknowledge this woman. I mean, she's not particularly strong as a character to begin with, but yeah, I feel like if she's got something going with this other guy and he's into her, this is not a love story. This is not a story about a man that must choose between science and love.
No, but eventually he will kind of make that choice. He'll choose love.
We'll see. I'll be curious to see where you feel that happens.
But he's not shy, you know. That's one thing, is a lot of mad scientists don't want to show their work. But here he's like, oh, I'm about to do this experiment. You can all watch. You can all be witness to my genius as I do the it's alive moment.
I love that what animates Frankenstein, it's not really the lightning. It's a special spectrum of light, a color that he has discovered that animates the cells, I guess. That's all the science we're going to get here.
Well, he told Wolderman had lectured on ultraviolet rays, and his machines see beyond that.
It goes above ultraviolet.
From beyond. I remember that was something that struck me about From Beyond, was the idea that you could see dimensions beyond what our eyes are capable of. That there might be things floating around us all the time that we just can't take in because we have human eyes. Whatever he's discovered, I think he's found it in lightning. And again, this is an invention entirely of this movie, that he's got these giant electrodes pointed to the sky and is going to, channel all of that God energy into, I mean, I think metaphorically it makes a lot of sense that if lightning comes from the heavens, that he's able to grab a bolt and stick it in a lifeless body and make it come to life. That feels like an act of God.
I love that it just kind of works with defibrillation too. The fact that doctors will now electrocute you to try to bring you back to life. And here we have him doing that, I believe, before defibrillation was a thing.
Yeah, not sure. This is not the doctor I would seek for medical attention. This is a line that always gets cut. Strangely enough, in his search for realism, director James Whale insisted that Boris Karloff be on that stretcher that is lifted up into the air. And Boris talked about how, like, I was really hoping they built the set right and I wasn't going to fall. And
yeah, it should be said for those who haven't seen this film, he is covered. You cannot see Boris Karloff on that gurney as he gets raised up. He's totally covered.
Yeah, you would put a dummy there.
Yeah.
Or maybe an extra. You would not risk hurting your star. This is filming in order, so you're really going to, again, you got a month to shoot this thing. You're really going to be hurt if that rope should break and he's suddenly, broken an arm, leg, or worse. But yes, after he gets zapped and comes down, we have Henry say the infamous line, "Now I know what it feels like to be God." Huge controversy. Real problem. Every cut of the movie after the initial release, they demanded that be removed. Sacrilegious.
Yeah, I can see why they'd want that line cut. Again, though, it's one of the more interesting things to me.
Yes, that's what Frankenstein is about. If you were going to make science fiction, you would want to explore what it is for man to step into the role of God. That's what it's about. But if you're trying to please audiences in the 1930s where religion is dominant and they'll be soon creating a production code to prevent sacrilegious things from getting to the eyes of young, impressionable people, I guess you don't make your movie about that. And it's too bad. You know, like, I feel like that's maybe one reason why I don't really like science fiction from this early on, is that they just aren't able to explore with any philosophical seriousness the themes.
But even though you get the it's alive moment, you still don't get a great look at Boris Karloff here. He stays on the table. We just see some hand movement. It's not like he gets up and immediately starts walking around. The focus is Victor Frankenstein, not his monster.
Yeah. Has anyone ever created a Frankenstein that you think of before this? When we finally do see him, it is, the movie's halfway over, about 30 minutes, they'll finally show Boris like slowly slink into frame. This is Frankenstein, right? Like this iteration, the idea that his head is a bucket and they just cut it open to slap the brain in there. And he's got the bolts in the neck and the giant boots.
Good enough for the Munsters.
No, I was going to say, this looks exactly the way they made Fred Gwynne look in the Munsters. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, well, and that makes sense because they were riffing so much on Universal Monsters in that show. But again, at any time, I'm asking you, think of all of cinema history. Have you ever seen a Frankenstein that was more iconic, that left even an impression on you? I can't. It is this.
No.
No, this is it. When you say a Frankenstein, even though it's not Frankenstein, it's Frankenstein's monster.
It's both. Who cares?
Yeah. Yo, Home Sweet Home Alone cares.
So dumb.
But when you think of Frankenstein, you think of the bolts in the neck, you think of the flat head, you think of Boris Karloff. It is the enduring image. It's why it's not part of this retrospective, but I'm very curious to see Robert De Niro play Frankenstein in that Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, because he would not look like this.
Yeah, they didn't go for that look. I remember exactly the makeup job on that. And again, they were going for what it was on the page, which wasn't much, and not what Universal. This is a compromise. This is three heads coming together. You have the director who said, I want the idea of a bucket. His head is like, an empty thing that you can just drop a cranium in. And then the makeup artist, Frank Pierce, who just worked on all the movies, he was like, we need to make sure the actor's dead in the eyes. So he built that brow up. And, you know, I don't study movie makeup, but what I've read about this process is it was pretty revolutionary and not how you would do it now. And so it really, poor Boris Karloff could barely hold open his eyes, had 60 pounds on his head.
It shows.
30 pounds on his feet. Apparently got severe back injury moving around here. His contribution is, I guess, Boris didn't have half his teeth. And so to help with the sunken look, he just removes his dentures. And that's partly why his face, you know, he's a starving actor. And so he was a gaunt person anyway. And then you remove those dentures, and that's how they're able to get that pucker around his lips.
And you could tell, like, they're proud of this makeup job. They're going to do, like, some real close-ups when he finally walks into the room and turns to the camera. And, yeah, it's impressive looking. Like, for almost 100 years old, it looks really good.
I agree. I mean, black and white probably does it some favors. I mean, Stuart, you called him green earlier. I have no idea what color he is. He's just gray. But I think it is a good-looking monster. I can see why it's endured for 100 years.
Nobody's thought of a better one. I mean, that's worth reflecting on, is nobody has been able to top this. And yes, any cartoon, any sitcom, anytime anyone says Frankenstein, they're talking about Boris Karloff in this movie. And yes, what do we know about Frankenstein? He hates fire. So we, you know, like, he's banished to the basement.
Yeah, you want to talk about iconic Frankensteins. I think of Phil Hartman in this makeup going, fire bad!
Even before that, though, yeah, we get this introduction and, like, sit. And I don't know, there is something about Karloff's performance. Maybe you talked about, like, the dead eyes. You could tell, like, that he's not the monster I'm talking about, not Karloff himself. But, like, yeah, there's something distant there. And the way he sits and then, like, looks up towards that moonlight coming through the roof as it's open. I don't know, there is something striking about this performance that makes me care about this monster. So, yeah, when he gets scared from that fire, like, I'm actually all of a sudden very concerned about his well-being.
This feels like the most important moment in the film, because you have a monster, right? It's a monster movie. Here he comes walking out. You bring a torch and swing at him. I expect a monster to bum rush you and kill you. Like, I'm not afraid of fire. That he is a child, essentially, that he recoils. And yes, the heaviness of his eyelids means that he's always looking kind of sad and crestfallen. His posture is always one of something dejected and lonely. I mean, this is like the first goth monster. It's a different take on a monster and not scary. I mean, that's the interesting thing is you might be scared of the look. I'm hearing that audiences were horrified by the makeup job, but this monster is not scary. He's not a killer. He doesn't have a criminal brain. He's not doing criminal things. He's a child that wasn't made for this world, that is not capable of navigating the circumstances he's put in.
I found I'm going on a similar journey with Frankenstein that I do with, like, King Kong, who this primal beast pulled out of what he knows and put into civilization, and he can't just work that way. And I talked about especially Peter Jackson's King Kong. I feel a lot of sympathy for that version of the ape. And, yeah, I find that with Frankenstein because he is vulnerable to, you know, he's scared of that fire, and we're going to see him. Fritz deserves to die. He horribly abuses him. And I'm feeling for Frankenstein this whole time.
Yeah, I don't think anyone would be scared that the monster hung the henchman. I don't think it would play that way. I guess maybe you're impressed that he's strong. He's capable of doing that. But I just, to me, he's not a fearsome creation. You mentioned King Kong, and that movie, I think it probably took from this. I mean, that movie didn't come out for two more years. So this is probably where it starts. The idea that sometimes the monster is the victim is being introduced by this movie.
But yes, he is going to kill Fritz, and Fritz is deserving. And you say he's not a killer. We're going to see him kill later on where it is not as deserved as Fritz.
He doesn't know he's killing, though.
At no point does he understand what death is. I mean, he barely knows what being alive is.
But killing Fritz is going to be enough for Frankenstein to agree to kill him. And they're going to poison him. Waldman and Frankenstein together are going to lure him out of the cell, inject him with a poison, and kill the monster.
Yes, and we have some comic relief here that we've had the other characters return to the house of Frankenstein, and one of my favorite supporting characters, this old Baron Frankenstein, is like, my son, he's mixed up with another woman. I know it.
Yes.
Like, I don't buy this whole scientific thing. Playing God, whatever that is.
He feels like he's from a totally different movie.
I love it. He is from a totally different movie. He would be from one of these drawing room comedies.
Yes.
Probably James Whale wishes he was making. Yes, it's definitely from a different world, and it's a nice counterbalance. It's nice to be able to cut away, have this little chuckle, and when this guy shows up, he can drag his son home and leave the dirty work to Waldman. Again, maybe this looks scary, that Frankenstein chokes him dead. I see that as self-preservation. I don't see that as a homicidal killer, a maniac.
He does do it only when the autopsy starts. Like, we don't get close-ups. I don't know if they didn't have the makeup technology or if it was too much to show, but it's like Waldman is about to do that first cut with the scalpel, or maybe has done the first cut with the scalpel, and that's when the monster reacts and decides to kill Waldman. It's an effective scene, though. I like this. I like Frankenstein as a killer. I don't want him to be mopey. I want him to be dangerous.
I'm torn because I agree with you, Arnie. The tension has to come with the fact that a guy created a monster and that this is for him to fix. You know, that he outsourced it to his mentor and his mentor's dead really puts it on Henry to, like, okay, now you got to be the one, right? So it's kind of weird that, like, all of a sudden he's just like, yeah, I want to be married, or I'm being forced to be married. The way it plays to me is Dad is making me do this whole marriage thing.
I take it as after he agrees to kill the monster, that he is turning away from that part of his life. Now, take this as a metaphor for whatever you will, but that he is recommitting himself to Elizabeth and marriage and normality, and he's trying to put that part of his life, his party days, behind him.
Yeah, but he's kind of a drip too, you know what I mean? Like, he's not a fun-loving guy. It's not like, we have one moment on a veranda where he's like, boy, I realize I was really consumed with my work, but, like, I don't feel tenderness, I don't feel passion. I mean, just having watched Gone with the Wind, that melodrama, when people are into each other, they play up to that, and Henry and Elizabeth are not a hot couple.
Yeah, unfortunately for me, many times when it's away from the lab and it's, yeah, this marriage melodrama, I do not care. I'm like, why is this in Frankenstein? This is bizarre to have so much time devoted to, like, it, and maybe this is telling because we're going to end with this line, to the son of Frankenstein. That seems to, like, be a big deal that Baron Frankenstein has, like, this passes his line down, and maybe not the way Henry's going about it by making monsters.
I'll agree that it's impossible to believe a 70-minute movie can drag, but these wedding scenes do that.
Really, I think they kind of look cool, though. I mean, like, this is a cool set.
They're well shot.
Yeah, they're well shot. When the villagers are drinking, and I mean, I just kind of love that they're just, like, there for the booze and, like, doing, like, circles and all of that. It allows for this beautiful counterpart. Because, yes, what's happening while they're dancing and drinking is Frankenstein is wandering around and making friends. This is a classic scene. I think everyone that knows the Frankenstein story knows that this happens. Crazy that Mary Shelley didn't put it in her book.
And crazy that they cut it out from all those cuts. I'd read that too, that this little girl scene was lost for many years and only rediscovered in the 80s.
Well, here's how they handle it. So in the censored later versions, we just see a little girl. She turns, she looks scared, and then we have a close-up of Frankenstein going, "Rrr!" Cut, and then we see the father carrying her lifeless body. So they never removed the idea of a little girl getting killed. You have to have that in order to understand why the village becomes the marauders. But they do not show what's really kind of just emotionally painful, that he wants to play. He sees flowers floating in the pond and thinks, well, she'll do that too, right?
And this is the scene, and I would have seen this in the early 80s. I don't know if it was restored fully or not in whatever cut I saw. But I remember Frankenstein kills a little girl, and it disturbed me because, yeah, it wasn't a violent thing. It was just like this casual, oops, I'm an oof that doesn't understand the world, and now you're dead. And that, like, haunted me as a child.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yeah. It is kind of a sad scene because he doesn't understand what he's doing. This is the one murder where it's completely accidental.
That's what makes it horrific to me.
And yeah, it is, like you say, Stuart, such an iconic scene of him. And Boris Karloff is giving a really good performance here with that smile and acting childlike at seeing the flowers float and all of that. I really love what Karloff does with the monster in this film.
Yeah, there was a lot of pressure for them to get a big, muscular, hulking, scary dude. And I think it was James Whale that said, no, we need to like him. We need to have empathy. What he saw in Karloff was that even though he was tall, was that there was something kind of broken and despondent and sad. It was the sadness, I think, that in the eyes that he responded to. And he plays up here. And so for better or for worse, and I think it's both, we have a monster that's only horrific in that he can't function with the world. Every time he tries to connect, it means somebody dies or someone tries to hurt him. And yeah, it's a really impactful scene too, when the father, I don't know how he found his daughter. I don't know how he knows she's been murdered. But yeah, again, James Whale insists, little girl, we don't have a dummy. You're just going to be carried for this tracking shot and all day long, five takes.
It is such a long tracking shot too, and it is so impressive. I feel like all of a sudden I'm watching, I don't know, like French New Wave cinema with this tracking shot. It blew my mind, like how it goes from, like, the father is always sad holding his dead child, but all the villagers in the background at first, they're all just still partying, drinking that free beer from Baron Frankenstein. And as he progresses, like, they start to notice the body and this mob forms. It is, like, a really masterful shot.
It is really well done. I could tell that was the real girl. It just looked too much like her to be a dummy.
That dude looked like his arms were, like, giving out from carrying her too much.
I was just shocked at how far back her neck was bent too. I'm like, I was really worried for the safety of the girl being carried in this way. But yeah, it is a good shot.
She complained about severe back pain after this day.
I could see it.
Although, bit of gossip, not as bad as she would experience when she would go home. Her mom beat her. She later wrote a tell-all about how she was abused. Frankenstein was nicer to her than her mother.
That's sad.
But yes, after this, what I would call the original Stranger Danger story of Frankenstein playing with a child, everyone now is looking for this killer. Now, I don't know that they understand. I don't feel like Henry has told them who this is. But a line is said that they've gone to the watchtower and found the dead professor. So they know there's a killer around. And then we get a scene that I am still trying to process because it makes me laugh. And then I go, but should I be laughing?
Are you talking about Frankenstein's monster visiting the bride?
Yes, right.
Yes. Okay. Who I thought he killed at first, but she's just lying in that bed alive.
It's, look, again, as I'm experiencing this movie largely as a campy kind of thing, when she screams and he goes, that, laugh out loud, funny. Like, I think, oh, that's just a funny interplay. It feels like from Young Frankenstein. But yes, cutting away the way that they do and finding her later alive, she's not like... He scoops her up. The obvious thing would be that he kidnaps her, wants her for his own bride, and takes her away. The implication is rape.
I didn't take it as that. I took the implication as possible murder, and then he left.
But she's alive.
Yeah, but then he left. He didn't murder her.
Yeah, so she fainted. She got scared right at him. I didn't really know how to read the scene. I did not go to rape, though.
Well, what happens? She obviously didn't get away. And suddenly she's incapacitated and we have Henry turning to Victor and saying, she's your responsibility now. Because yes, the original idea would be that Henry would die trying to correct this problem and that she would end up with the person that really loved her.
That's how I thought it was going to go.
Yeah, you definitely are signaled that. And then decisions were made right at the end that they wanted sequels.
They were doing that even back then, huh? It didn't start with LL Cool J on H2O.
Nope, definitely not. Yeah, Universal is alive because it has Universal Monsters. That franchise is what kept it in business past 1931.
But now we have this mob, and you guys talked about the production values, and yeah, they've got a lot of people here going around searching for the monster. Henry Frankenstein is put in charge of one of the groups of people doing the hunt.
Yeah, he's the one that finds his creation, and then they have this kind of moment. There's a couple of scenes that really kind of visually set up the idea that they're one and the same, right? They're staring into each other, and creator and creation. I wish more could come out of that. I agree with you. This is where the frustration about Henry as a character really comes to bear, is what is he going to do? How does he hope to atone? Anything that this monster has done, anyone that he's killed, that's blood on Henry's hands. This is not a monster. This is a child that had no parent.
But yet, because of the killings he's done, I do take him as a monstrous killer, but a monster, not a villain, you know? Kind of like King Kong, again. If you trap an animal will kill in self-defense. A lion will maul people the way Frankenstein will kill people coming after him. But yet, he kills with such a carefree attitude about it that he does come across monstrous to me. I do think he's a good movie monster.
It's worth pointing out, they could have gone the way of the book, and they could have, in lots of ways. But the book was set up at the ending that Frankenstein's monster came to his creator's wedding specifically to kill Elizabeth. And because Frankenstein wouldn't make a bride for him, he wasn't going to allow his creator to have a life he couldn't have. And that felt monstrous. That characterization did feel like, okay, this is kind of an evil creation, or at least a bitter, you know, vindictive one. Here, again, I never feel like I'm watching anything other than an innocent child.
Yeah, innocent child, wild animal. I don't think this is a being that has high functioning brain abilities. Like, he's not thinking much more than just survival.
Yeah, how much does he even understand? He can't speak, he can barely move. And yeah, again, people are just so mean to it. Their natural response is to scream, to pass out, to attack him, to, you know, sling torches at him. Is he bad? I mean, or wouldn't anyone do that in that circumstance?
Yeah, in a way, he's kind of the anti-Dracula, where that was the foreigner coming in and ruining mm-hmm. everything. And this is the foreigner coming in, and like everyone just hates him for no reason. And like, he hasn't done anything wrong.
Yeah. But we're at the climax. Yeah, only a 70-minute movie, really. And so, again, the windmill at some point was the lab and got switched around. I don't know if production had trouble. I'm not sure where that choice was made, but it does make for a spectacular vision once the villagers... Well, first, we have Frankenstein toss his creator onto the ground, and he hits the slat of the windmill. He got to be dead, right?
He's dead for sure, yeah.
I thought he was dead, but I guess that slat of the windmill broke his fall.
And other things, like his spine. Yeah, it clearly the original intent was he's dead. And you want him dead. Again, he's the monster.
He's the one who sinned. He should be the one dying.
Yes, correct. The monster is just bringing home to roost your arrogance for trying to be God. That's the lesson being taught here. But yes, he hits that. Some people scoop him up and then they burn down that windmill with a pretty definitive shot of Frankenstein's monster trapped under a beam, burning, crying, looking pretty dead.
Oh, it's killing me the way he is screaming in pain and fear. Like, I'm shocked, like, how much I'm being moved by this monster.
Yeah. I agree. It is surprising that they're getting genuine emotion out of story that feels beyond cliche, quite frankly. Like something that I felt I knew in my bones.
Yes.
Yeah, it really does. And that's really harming my enjoyment of it. You know, I said Karloff gives a great performance and I'll stand by that. But yet I can't say that overall I'm having as great a time with this movie as I am with his performance.
Yeah, no, it's about how they're doing it, because I feel like the story is overly familiar. But again, the way I remember the story is the mad scientist died, and here we get in the epilogue, my favorite needless character.
This is such a weird ending for a horror movie, a monster movie.
Yeah, the Baron just grabbing a wine and toasting the House of Frankenstein, and yeah. That it's there, everything's fine, no problem.
It is such a comedic ending. The house servants bring this rare wine and they're like, maybe this will help Henry. And the Baron looks at Henry and is like, he doesn't need it. And the Baron drinks the wine.
It's such a bizarre ending.
I'm laughing, it's working.
I am laughing. Yeah, that's true.
Well, are you smiling when I ask, Jacob, Stuart, do you recommend Frankenstein? Jacob.
I was kind of fearing this one just after that original Bela Lugosi Dracula was such a letdown for me. So coming back to this, I was surprised. Like, there's definitely things that feel like 1931. Like, there's not a great development of Henry's character. What does the monster mean to him? All things that I would want to see explored in a serious Frankenstein film. But it's 1931. They're making a monster picture, you know, to scare you. It's so scary they got a warning at the beginning. And the shock to me is, yeah, Boris Karloff, how much I am moved by his performance. Not just, like, great makeup. Yes, he looks great as this monster. The way they frame him in that moonlight when he's introduced is all great. But the fact that I care about this monster in this film, when he's being abused by Fritz, when he's pinned down at the end underneath those fiery beams. And then there's just some great shots here. Like I talked about that father walking his dead daughter down through the town. Like I was really surprised by the technical prowess of the film and with makeup shots, all that kind of stuff. And then just the emotional stuff, even though it's not the deepest story, it hit me. And that was a nice little surprise. So yeah, for sure. I'm sorry. I'm still not going to tell you to go see Bella and Dracula. But yes, see Boris Karloff and Frankenstein. This was very impressive. A solid recommend.
Stuart.
Yeah, I want to start by just saying Frankenstein's not my dude. I'd much rather watch a vampire or Dracula story in general because it's just hard to relate to a creature like this. No, don't get me wrong. I'm an introvert. I can relate to introverted characters on the screen. But when you have a monster movie, you want that to be an active, aggressive, scary figure. And Frankenstein is not that. You know, he's goth. He's fish out of water. He just wants to be left alone. Incredible Hulk, Edward Scissorhands. We've seen it a lot. And none of those figures are ones that are going to give you nightmares. What I would add on top of that is it feels like such an iconic story that it borders actually on cliche. You know so much about what's going to happen that there's very little surprise to what you experience. So what I have to compliment is the work of this technical crew. James Whale has the right comedic sensibilities to make this feel lively and enjoyable. And all these technicians, the sets they've built, Boris Karloff's performance, you've cited it. Jacob, the moments that stood out for you are the moments that stand out for me. The father holding his child, the Frankenstein trying to relate to the girl and then you know, inadvertently killing her, the Baron, like, trying to find the mistress, and, yeah, walking in from a screwball comedy next door. It is alive. That is what I'm going to say. This Frankenstein has a lot of vitality and life to it that makes it so much better than a lot of these stiff 1930s early talkies that just were stage-bound and not very impressive, things that needed to be remade. And so, yeah, my compliment is that I'm thoroughly impressed and entertained by this story. It moves fast, it gets through all the parts that you expect, and works in some surprises along the way. I'm gratified to be able to recommend it.
And I didn't enjoy this film as much as my co-host did, and I think, Stuart, you nailed the reason why, is because this is so much in the cultural zeitgeist that it does border on cliche. I'd never seen this movie, but I've seen this movie. You know, I had that reaction with Jaws when we reviewed that way back when, and I said, I never saw Jaws because I didn't need to see Jaws. I knew Jaws. Well, then I saw Jaws, and there was so much more to it than just we need a bigger boat. And yet, here with Frankenstein, yeah, you've seen it in Snickers commercials, you've seen it in Mel Brooks parodies, you've seen this movie, even if you haven't. And so that was a negative for me, is that I didn't feel it held much in the way of surprise, except for being very well made for a 1931 film, feeling fairly modern in its composition of shots, in the tracking shots like you guys discussed. And I really like Boris Karloff's performance, although the rest of the performances are fairly stilted, as is common for the time period. I mean, it's a film of its time, and that's a bit of a negative for me. I have trouble warming to older films, this old especially.
Mm-hmm.
When we reviewed Gone with the Wind, one thing I called out is I felt like the acting there was more naturalistic. And here, this is more the type of performance I expect from a 1930s film. But I was a little bit torn, but I like Karloff enough. I like this monster enough. I'm going to give it a weak recommend. It's going to get a pass. So 3 recommends for the green guy on his first outing.
Yeah, I can't dispute anything that you're saying, but the thing that's remarkable is some scenes play just as well now as they did 92 years ago.
Yeah.
That's why you recommend this movie, because it still has that vitality. It still is alive and can make you care in the moment. It can make those cliches, you understand why they became cliches, why they are so repeated again and again. It'll always have a historical importance. There's always a reason to go back and see something this iconic, but I think people are going to have a good time when they do it. And I don't always say that.
Not just homework in now playing terms.
Yeah. And will that be true of The Bride of Frankenstein? Well, the reputation is, this is one you always pull out when you want to talk about sequels being better than the original. Bride of Frankenstein, at least by the critics of its day, and the people on the commentary track now, say that this is the best Universal monster movie ever made. We'll find out next week.
So you're saying as good as Godfather 2? Stuart's words, not mine.
I didn't say anything about Godfather. I just said it's better than The Creature of the Black Lagoon.
You're saying it joined that club of sequels that precede their original.
Yes. Well, I don't think that's true of Godfather Part 2.
Neither do I.
But yes, some people say that. Yes, they do say that about that movie.
So as good as Empire Strikes Back. Your words, not mine.
You're bending my words. I didn't say that. I'm saying in the same way you could hold up Empire as better than Star Wars, you could hold up Bride as better than this first Boris Karloff.
Okay.
But we'll see. I don't know. I have seen it before, and I don't hazy, blurry memories. We'll have to check it out again and get back with you next week.
I'm a total newbie, so I'm seeing it for the first time, and yet I've seen Weird Science, so do I need to see it?
We should do Weird Science.
I mean, we will, right? That feels inevitable. But in the meantime, in case you do want to watch some older movies, join us on Fridays. We were just talking about a 1939 classic, Gone with the Wind, last month. We covered that for December patrons. This Friday, we got a more recent film, but still one that is, 40 years old. Thief, Michael Mann, James Caan.
A favorite of mine.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Mann's best film. I'm going to just say it now. Move over, Heat.
Never seen it. Maybe 2024 is the year of me being the newbie on Now Playing, because I hadn't even heard of Thief before it was picked by one of our patrons. So looking forward to it. Always excited for Michael Mann.
Yeah, he's got a new movie out now with Ferrari, and we're about to talk a lot about 80s cops and robbers. So it seems like the right time to cover this film.
So hopefully you can be a Now Playing patron. While Stuart said, you know, Gone with the Wind was for December patrons, it is available. If you become a patron patron of $10 or more now through Apple, through Spotify, on Podbean, or on Patreon, you get over 80 exclusive bonus reviews. They just keep amassing with a new one added each month. Gone with the Wind was December's edition, and Thief is January's edition. A lot of content for just $10, and that $10 goes so far to helping us keep this show going. It really matters. You know, it adds up with the more people we get just giving us $10. It keeps the show afloat and allows us to keep doing what we love doing and hopefully you love hearing. So thank you for being a supporter. Thank you very much for listening to this episode of Now Playing on our totally free Tuesday feed. Jakob Stuart, thank you for joining me. Good night all, and pleasant dreams.
Strange man you call a monster is dead.
Thank you for listening to this Now Playing Podcast movie review. We hope you enjoyed the show.
I must continue my experiments.
Help us spread the word about this show by leaving a 5-star review on Stitcher, Podbean, iTunes, or your podcast store of choice.
It's my friend. He does things for me.
Want more reviews like this one? In the archives section of NowPlayingPodcast.com, you'll find more than 1,000 in-depth movie reviews from our panel of hosts.
Before you came, I was all alone. It is bad to be alone.
On our site, you can hear reviews for every installment in the world's biggest film franchises, including the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Star Wars, Spider-Man, Batman, X-Men, James Bond, Middle Earth, Jurassic Park, Fast and Furious, and Transformers.
But this isn't science. It's more like black magic.
Plus, we have individual movie reviews, such as Titanic, E.T., Inception, Big Hero 6, Ready Player One, Pulp Fiction, Apocalypse Now, Doctor Strangelove, and hundreds more.
Your health will be ruined if you persist in this madness.
And come back to NowPlayingPodcast.com next Tuesday for another all-new movie review podcast.
We're going to explore something so foreign to us, we can't even imagine what it's going to be like.
Support from listeners like you keeps Now Playing Podcast on the air.
Thank you. Thank you for your courtesy.
You can donate directly by tapping the support button at NowPlayingPodcast.com. And you can join our crowdfunding campaign for early access to new episodes, exclusive reviews, and bonus reviews.
You'll do as I say, and you will have everything you want.
Now Playing Podcast is produced by Arnie Carvalho.
Here he planned a miracle. Saw it come to pass.
Associate produced by Jason Latham.
He's completely superhuman.
Now Playing is edited by Heath, Santiago, and Arnie.
I'm exhausted. I must get sleep.
What? Finish.
Now Playing credits read by Brock.
How beautifully dramatic.
The opinions expressed in this podcast are those of the individual hosts and may not reflect the views of Venganza Media Incorporated.
Nobody'll believe me. Right? I'll wash my hands of it. Let them all be murdered in the beds.
Venganza Media Incorporated is not affiliated with, and this podcast has not been prepared, approved, or licensed by any entity that created the film analyzed herein. All movie clips and music included in this podcast are the intellectual property of their respective copyright holders. They are included here for the purpose of review, and no infringement is intended.
As long as you continue to live in this place, you're in danger.
Now Playing Podcast is an exclusive trademark of and may not be used without the express written permission of Venganza Media Incorporated.
You're speaking in riddles, Herr Inspector.
Now Playing is a Venganza Media production, copyright 2024, and no part of this show may be reproduced, repurposed, or redistributed without the written permission of Venganza Media Incorporated. All rights reserved.
We belong dead.